Hello and welcome to What is the ERA and Why Do We Need It? This is the March meeting of the League of Women Voters of Anoka Blaine, Coon Rapids area. I'm Sue Durgantz, a member of the League of Women Voters ABC Program Committee, and I welcome you to our program this evening. Our guest today is Suzann Whillhite, president of ERA Minnesota, which is a nonprofit volunteer organization that focuses on working to make equal legal rights for all a reality through adoption of an equal rights amendment in the Minnesota Constitution. This is important because neither the Minnesota nor the U.S. Constitution specifically provide equal legal protection under the law, regardless of sex and gender. Minnesota's first major victory in the fight for equal rights came in 1973, when we ratified the Federal Equal Rights Amendment, becoming the 26th state to ratify it. However, efforts to add the ERA to the U.S. Constitution stalled on June 30, 1982, as not enough states voted to ratify before the arbitrary time limit kicked in. Now more states have ratified the amendment, and the threshold has been met, and efforts are shifting to getting the ERA adopted into the U.S. Constitution. Suzann will tell us about the Equal Rights Amendment now moving in Minnesota, the history of inequality in the U.S., the U.S. and Minnesota constitutions, why the ERA matters, and what action is needed now. Suzann, welcome to the League of Women Voters, ABC. My friend, Suzann.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So I know that the League has a long history with the ERA and with voting, and so we've got similar histories. So I'm Suzann Whillhite, as you mentioned. The founder of ERA Minnesota was Betty Folliard. She was a representative for many years, and that was in 2014. She really jump-started, and a lot of things did happen. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about the history. ERA Minnesota, what is the ERA? Hopefully everybody knows what it is, but not every young person does. That's why I have new buttons that actually spell it out, because I got asked, ERA, what's that? And so most people know it's ERA, and it's the Equal Rights Amendment. So brief history, why do we need it? The arguments for and against, because some of those still exist. And why now? Why are we still fighting for this? And some next steps that are happening in Minnesota, which is promising. So here we have the front of the Supreme Court in Washington, D.C., and we've got Lady Justice up there at the top. But as you know, we didn't have a woman as a Supreme Court Justice until Sandra Day O'Connor in the 70s. So we have a long history of laws that did not include women, so except for. We are on the outside, but not on the inside. So what is it? There's two levels, and this is always like a civics lesson and a little bit of history of having a federal constitution for our nation and state constitutions for each state. And other states have equal rights amendments in their state constitutions. Minnesota does not, and we need it. So I'll make that argument. But it's very simple, 24 words. Equality of rights under the law shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. And we are still working to get that amendment in our Constitution. Been a long, long battle. As a matter of fact, it was introduced after women got the right to vote, the 19th Amendment, the 20th in 1920, and it's now 100 years since it was introduced. So 1923, it's now 2023. Long past time to get this done. We also have a state equal rights amendment that we are proposing, and we just proposed new language in 2023. We had very similar language to the federal, but other states have added more inclusive language, and in Nevada, they passed this language, equality under the law shall not be abridged or denied by this state or any of its cities, counties, or other political subdivisions on account of race, color, creed, sex, sexual orientation, gender identity or expression, age, disability, ancestry, or national origin. We're hoping that's all And we just want equal rights for all people. So this is what's proposed in our Minnesota legislature to be able to have an equal rights amendment in our state constitution. So one of the things, I just added this, and I know there's a lot of text here, but this shouldn't be so scary because we already have a Minnesota Human Rights Act. That's a law. And we've had a Department of Human Rights since 1967. Now, we have been adding rights in that under amendments to the law, and that is updated. And so even, you know, you've heard 2013, we added legalized same-sex marriage. But the key word is law. Laws can be changed with the next legislative session. They can be amended, they can be changed, they can be eliminated. And we've seen where laws have been eliminated or not renewed in the past. So that's why we want to put equality in the Constitution, both nationally and in Minnesota. And currently, you look at the language for that Human Rights Act, and there's quite a bit that's already in here that we're repeating into our state ERA. So that's an important thing to remember. We're not, adding something totally new here. We're building on a law that's already been in place. So brief history, and a lot of this has to do similar with getting the right to vote. We had English common law, and women were property. We were covered under the male of the household, whether that was the father, the husband, or even a son, that women couldn't own property, and we were the property. And we had to be added even to get the right to vote, I mean, which took until 1920. So this history is how our country started. And so we've been, look at this picture, you see it's a room full of basically white men. And it was white men with property, and most of us were the property, whether you were enslaved, Asian, Native American, women, did not have rights. And so we've had to add them. Famously, 1848, Seneca Falls, Declaration of Sentiments. They chose one to go for, and that was the right to vote. There was a whole list, and they wanted equal rights. And so been fighting ever since. There was commonality with abolitionists because of being enslaved and having the lack of rights. So a lot of abolitionist women worked together for equal rights. And then there was a divide and split. The many years that women struggled to get attention, because of course they couldn't vote, they had no input into government. So they would show up and rally and have major events to get attention. And they were heckled, and actually some were accosted. But finally, what happens is actually male slave get the right to vote. And that split a lot of women who had been working with the abolition movement. They were unhappy that black males, and it's the first time male was introduced in the Constitution federally, to say, oh, we don't get the right to vote, but black men do. And Frederick Douglass said, I got to take it. You know, we got to have it because at least we can move forward. The 20th Amendment, as you know, didn't necessarily give black women the right to vote because they were allowed to have restrictions at the state level. So that's where Jim Crow, Jane Crow would still prohibit voting in some states. But women did get the right to vote, 1920, 19th Amendment, and immediately Alice Paul, who was the rebel side of getting the women's suffrage and right to vote, she went for the equal rights because this is really what was wanted in the first place. And there are three components to her equal rights amendment. It was based on the 19th Amendment to not discriminate on the basis of sex. It had a section two that said that Congress should have the power to enforce it. And then the amendment would take effect 2 years after the date. So laws could be updated, cleaned up. And so she was very instrumental in pushing for getting the right to vote and then the Equal Rights Amendment. So here we go again, starting with women, 1923, almost 50 years they introduced the Equal Rights Amendment, and it goes nowhere, because there's a man who's the chair of the committee who laughs at this and thinks, no way, that's not going to happen. And that's the power of being the chair of a committee. He simply would not give it a hearing, not move it forward. And so more and more involvement was needed, pushed to get that moving in the federal level in Congress. So, as you remember, there was a civil rights movement, then there was a women's rights movement, and finally, 1972, women had swarmed the Capitol, and they were demanding equal rights for the Congress to pass the law that would send it out to the states. They need 3/4, that was 38 states needed to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment. So 1972, Congress finally is pressured enough to pass it, both houses, and actually was a significant majority in both. It was well supported. It starts out, Minnesota ratified in 1973. I show you this, and there's a lot of text here, but within this proposed amendment, Alice Paul looked at it, and she nearly wept because she said, oh, there's a poison pill in here. 7 years. It was given 7 years to pass through the required number of states. And that was a limitation because they knew they needed to do a lot of work to get the states to ratify. Some states came on immediately. Hawaii and Alaska, they ratified the same day it was passed because of the time zone change. So Hawaii claims to be the first, and I think Alaska is the second, that ratified, Minnesota ratified in 1973. But there's a question about this, because remember what this is. There's a preamble, introduction. That's where the time limit is. All of the states voted on the 24 words. They didn't vote on the preamble. So this becomes a lawyer fight about it issue as it gets to completion. So this is where the language matters, and we will see how this gets worked out. But that's how the proposed amendment was. Here we are. So that gets sent out in 1972. It has a 7-year time limit. Congress extends it 3 more years. It was under, and it passed again to have that 3-year, but no more states came on because there was a backlash. As if they move forward, then you get people who say, no, we don't want that. People probably remember Phyllis Schlafly. Oh, yes. She's credited, but there was a lot of people involved. And sadly, she was quite a smart woman. She had help, and she had 6 children and a live-in maid. She did get her law degree, and she tried and ran for Congress 3 times and lost. She was a very smart woman. Feels like she got her energy misdirected because she actually couldn't do the things she wanted to do. So she organized the opposition to this, and she was very proud of her role in that. And the Eagle Forum still exists. Her daughter runs that, and she actually just died. She actually endorsed Trump. She put a book out, and so she was alive 2016. So she had a long history and was very proud of her activism in opposition to equal rights. So why do we still need it? Why are we still talking about this? Don't we have a lot of laws out there that help us and already address these issues? We do have a lot of laws, but we also have a lot of sex discrimination. And I just was hearing with International Women's Day, the pay gap has not moved in 20 years. And the United Nations claimed on last Wednesday that if we keep on the same track, it will be another 320 years before we get equality in terms of pay, because it is so slow to move. And so we're just not seeing equality being implemented even with the current laws. We know there's sexual harassment, sex discrimination, whole Me Too movement was a big, showcase of that. Sexual violence. Finally, VAWA got the Violence Against Women Act got renewed. So And then we see with COVID pandemic, we saw how women left the workforce, whether to go home with children or to care for elderly, and they haven't come back fully into the workforce. So, and then we saw where the Supreme Court overturned some of the protections that we had. So women actually lost rights, not gained them, but lost. So we have, as I mentioned, the gender pay gap, still at 82 cents a dollar for white women. But for Latina women, same work, 52, 54 cents. That means a whole nother year that you work to get the pay that is difference from male to female, which creates all kinds of problems down the road with less money. And being heads of households, women bear that impact much more. And if you're two parents, having a lesser income by one of those persons negatively impacts just the economic opportunities for the family. Sexual harassment, we know about this, and even young people. You might say, oh, well, that'll go away. No, it doesn't. It's systemic, and even with laws, we still have sexual harassment and sex discrimination in the workplace. Sexual violence, we know this is still occurring, and oftentimes it's not addressed. There isn't a good remedy for whether it's rape and the number of rape kits that sit on a shelf somewhere and never get addressed. As I mentioned, the Violence Against Women Act finally got renewed. It was declared unconstitutional, and then it had a boyfriend loophole where it had a gun issue, red flag piece, and they didn't want to renew it with that gun control piece in there. So it is a challenge because there's just little things that can disrupt a law, and when you think it's doing well, it isn't necessarily going to be continue to be in enforced. Healthcare, we know even with the Affordable Care Act, there was some positive aspects of gender equity with that, but we also know that employers, private employers, can limit healthcare to their employees. So comprehensive healthcare is still lacking. So what were the arguments? Some of you probably remember these. Originally, the Republican Party introduced this in the 1930s. They put it in their plank, their platform. And Democrats were late to the party, but they both carried it in their party platforms for many years. So it's not a partisan issue. It's a human rights issue to me, equality under the law, but it has become a party issue. And currently, that has changed. The Republican Party took it out of their platform in the early 80s with Ronald Reagan. So, okay, but what about the 14th Amendment? Equal protection, right? Okay, but which number is bigger, 14th or 19th? Women didn't get the right to vote with the 14th Amendment. It has not been interpreted that way by people who see it as originalist or textualist. They go back to 1787. They say, well, what was the thinking back then? Well, women didn't have rights back then. So the 14th Amendment has been used in some cases, and Ruth Bader Ginsburg tried to use it, and she usually used it with a male case to prove the point. But it also has not provided the equal protection that some people say it should. And we've had different courts, as we know. We've had more liberal courts, Earl Warren Court. We saw strengthening for equal protection. But with the John Roberts Court, we've seen that go backwards. So Supreme Court justices can have different interpretations, especially, as I mentioned, if you have an originalist who goes back to 1787. Then we lose on that. So that's a difference. And, of course, we have a case with Scalia who said, and he was an originalist, if we could choose an amendment to add, RBG would have chosen the Equal Rights Amendment, but Scalia said certainly the Constitution does not require discrimination on the basis of sex. The only issue is whether it prohibits it. It doesn't. That was his interpretation. So as a Supreme Court justice, that's how he's seeing these cases. That was 2011. Now, we do have more originalists or textualists on the court now, So that's why we get some of these decisions. So it matters who's in the seats and what they think, how to interpret the Constitution. So another argument was, well, we have all these laws. You know, we have the Paycheck Fairness Act. We have 1964 some laws about paycheck. But they don't get upheld to the level that we see when they end up in a court of law like Lilly Ledbetter, who'd been paid less her entire lifetime working for Goodyear. She'd trained in men that had higher salaries than she did. And what they said was, well, you needed to know you were being paid less within 6 months of being hired. 6 months. How many of you are feeling like you know, or if you're in a private business, do you ever know what other people are being paid? Most people don't talk about it, and they don't know. So if you haven't just, you know, figured that out in 6 months, too bad for you. So little loopholes in the law allow pay discrimination to continue. That was one of the first executive orders Obama signed, was the Lilly Ledbetter Act. But it's an act, and they can get overturned, so it didn't have the full force. So it also has to do with the scrutiny of it. So, you know, in legal terms, that means what's your likelihood? Race, religion, national origin have the highest level of scrutiny and the highest degree for prevention of discrimination. Sex does not. That's why we want to add it. So another argument was that it would expand abortion rights. There are now 27 states that have an equal rights amendment. Nevada just passed this language in November of last year. That it hasn't expanded, but it hasn't allowed more restrictions. So in New Mexico, where they said, no, you can't spend federal money on health care for women, they said, we have an equal rights amendment in our state constitution. That's discrimination on the basis of sex. They won that. And they were able to allow to have that funding in New Mexico because of their equal rights amendment. So there have been cases where a state equal rights amendment has been protective of rights. Another one was military. Remember, we were all going to get drafted. It was the 70s, there was the Vietnam War, and the fear that, women are going to have to be drafted. Well, we knew that women had always been in war, one way or another, and some of them participated actively. And now we have a voluntary military. We don't have a draft. And women serve voluntarily, and they are discriminated against in their opportunities to work in combat areas. And they get paid less and are limited in what jobs they can have. So we have a military that's currently discriminating on the basis of sex because they can. And there are plenty of women who have joined military expecting to be able to reach their goals, and they're willing to do it. The likelihood that we're going to get a draft, pretty slim. But I also think a lot of women would sign up, and they do, and they want to go. So I think this is something that was a fear of, women are going to get drafted, isn't that sad? But we have women who voluntarily join and support our military. So why now? Why do we care now? I mean, it's been 100 years. You know, a lot of women gave up, and they thought, they just gave up because they thought, we just can't get over this hill. But this map shows the federal ERA, and you look at this map, and maybe you see something here with the southeast. Kind of looks like a Civil War map, except for a little out west. Those three states in yellow, taupe, are three states that after 2016 ratified the Equal Rights Amendment. And they're challenging that timeline. Nevada was the first state that had a majority women legislature. And they said, what about a living wage? What about health care? What about family leave? What about that Equal Rights Amendment? Let's ratify that. Because these were issues that mattered to their lives. So they did. Illinois, home of Phyllis Schlafly, ratified the Equal Rights Amendment 2018. So 2017 Nevada, 2018 Illinois, Virginia worked 10 years to elect pro-ERA candidates. They had women in both leadership roles in their legislature. They passed it in January of 2020. So now you have 38 states that have ratified. You still have states that haven't, but some of these very states also have a state equal rights amendment. So it's a little bit of a confusion there, like, what's going on? But you look at this, you know, Alaska, Hawaii, I mean, there's a lot of pink there. And most people think that it's already happened. They thought that passed in the 70s. So don't we already have that equal rights amendment? And many states put it in their state constitutions at the same time. But some, like California, boy, when were they? They were like 18 when they became a state. Wyoming, because of course they had given women the right to vote when they were a territory. So they thought, they've got a tremendous equal rights amendment. It just includes everybody to have equal rights. So there are states that have had one form or another of an equal rights amendment for, well, over 100 years. And guess what? The world didn't end. And you probably can't even tell which states have those. And men and women have used them, more men than women, frankly. That's because they know about them and they have the resources. If they're discriminated in pay in a work, they've used their state equal rights amendment. So this isn't some apocalyptic unknown terror. We don't know what's going to happen if that. No, we do know what's going to happen. The states are already out there, and they've had them for many years for a state equal rights amendment. Maine has been working on this a very long time, and they get very close, but they just can't get over the top. So Minnesota said, hey, what about us? Why don't we have a state equal rights amendment? So that's been what Betty founded in 2016. And other people have worked on this too, to some degree, but we have a great opportunity to get it through now. So why do we need a state equal rights amendment? We have federal laws, we have state laws. We want protection at the federal level, we also want protection at the state level. So it's a two-level process, and we want to have sex discrimination prohibited. And now with a new language, we want to have all people to not be discriminated on those various categories. And all means all. So United States, sadly, is only, 187 other countries have some form of equal rights amendment. The United Nations, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, Article 7, all are equal before the law and are entitled without any discrimination to equal protection. Do you know who hasn't signed on to this yet? United States. Somalia, Samoa, a couple little tiny islands. We're not exactly stellar in the legal human rights category. So it's something that we at ERA Minnesota say, we want it in the state, we're going to help at the federal level. I was there in Virginia and yelled my head off when it passed. 2 weeks before, the Trump administration had issued a memo to bar the publishing of that 28th Amendment. They knew it was coming, and they wanted to stop it. So we should have a 28th Amendment federally, and we should have a state equal rights amendment in Minnesota. So we're educating people, letting people know. League of Women Voters is a big supporter. It's part of your legislative agenda. So we're happy when the League shows up. And just last week, we had the International Women's Day, and we had great support from League of Women Voters. Yes, you were there. And we have good reception. Sadly, it's still a partisan issue now in Minnesota. It wasn't. We've had Republicans author our equal rights amendment bill, even 2 years ago. Carla Nelson out of Rochester. And so there are still some that would support it, and we're going to hope we can get more of them on board, because it's not a political, it's a human rights issue, as we've seen with many other states that have it. So we're building that network of supporters. We have great supporters at the federal level. Both of our senators support this, and they work to finish it. Here are our bills. We have two bills. One is The 173 House file and Senate file 37, that's our state equal rights amendment. That's the language I put out there, and we've got cards in the back right over here with that language. This is a big education piece to let people know the language is more inclusive. And then we also have a resolution to Congress. It's a please finish the job here resolution. And we actually got to get a few Republicans that signed on to that. There used to be more. But essentially it's saying Minnesota ratified in 1973. We're still waiting for the Equal Rights Amendment. Please get it done. So that's why we have two, state level and then a resolution to Congress to say finish the work. We've got new authors at the federal level, Ayanna Presley. Rock star, she's excellent. They just had a big news conference about 3 weeks ago. And they have a new approach in terms of the timeline because the U.S. House has deleted the timeline two sessions. It's the Senate, the U.S. Senate, that says, oh, we have a filibuster level. We have this supermajority you have to do. Well, we'll see. So we're still fighting at that level. So that's why two bills, state ERA, and then the resolution. So the second one is the resolution. And right now, this is probably hard to read, but we've gotten through, this is the Senate, we had to go to the judiciary, and then we just passed through rules on International Women's Day. Carrie Dietzick is the chair, and we made it through both bills. And the next stop is the Senate floor for the Senate bills. So I drew this because I had to give civic lessons over and over and over again, like, where does it go next? The Senate bill, ready for the floor. The House, we went through state government, and now we're waiting to go through rules. Jamie Long is the chair of the Rules Committee, and we're hearing that they're doing budget bills and that they'll do it after they get done with the budget bills. But what we know is it's not done till it's done. And we want to put the heat on and keep the heat on that they pass these through. There has not been a lot of controversy about this bill. We do get questions from the Republicans about the word, well, we got the question about the word age. That was interesting. The definition of age, we cleared that one up pretty quick. But then there was a question about gender expression. And there was a question about trans in sports. And these are issues that are being resolved as we speak. For young people, they don't see this as an issue at all. This is the language they use. For older people, they question this. But back to our human rights bill, our Human Rights Act in Minnesota, we have gender identity in there. We also have sexual orientation. So we have been living under these laws for many years, and there's nothing scary or apocalyptic about it. So we want to get through rules, and then we don't know whether we'll have to go through judiciary in the House. But it's good news on the Senate side. We're ready for that vote. In the House side, rules, possibly judiciary, and then a floor vote. So that all that does is put it on the ballot for all of Minnesotans to vote. And that's all we're asking. Give Minnesotans an opportunity to vote yes or no. If they say no, that's the will of the people. But one of the things about our state constitution, you cannot leave it blank or it's a no vote. That's one of the requirements in Minnesota. Some states offer a referendum. You can get so many signatures, put it on the ballot. We can't do that. We have to go through the legislature. So we need to get it on the ballot and let people vote, and in a huge education campaign of to vote yes, depending on the wording, but we're hoping for a vote yes, and why they can't leave it blank. So it's important to me. I mean, here's a picture from our Wednesday, International Women's Day. People went out and about to see their legislators. We swarmed around the Capitol with our little purple hats on, and quite a good support. So I've got some sign-up sheets. You can sign up to get information. I send out information as we know about where we're going through committees. And then it'll be a huge education campaign to get people informed. But advocating, talking about it with friends, family, people who don't know, younger people don't know, they assume we already have equal rights. And we don't. So we need to have that discussion and around the coffee table and at the state fair and wherever else we can have that conversation. So to me, it's a basic human rights issue. So that's why I'm here. I believe in equality for all people. So with that, I would open it up to questions and any discussion that you go ahead.
They discussed the word creed.
Yes. So, yes, they're doing some research about that. So in Nevada, this is Nevada's language. And creed is related to beliefs and values. And New York is actually going to put this language of creed or religion on their amendment. They've got additional protections for New York. They're also going to vote on it. They had to pass through two legislative sessions in New York, and they're going to be on the ballot in 2024. So we chose Nevada's language because it was proven passable. 58% of their voters said yes. But the word creed, religion is already protected in our Constitution. Matter of fact, it's in the preamble. There's a lot of he about it, but as in he and him. But this is part of the issue with our Constitution is that we want it to apply to all people, and that's one of the, another bill actually Representative Bonner has is to redo our Constitution that would be more inclusive language. Because when you read it, and I read it, and I see he, him, it's awkward now. I mean, so to make it not male-centered, but people-centered. So would it change? It is possible that our legislators may tweak the language, but religion is already protected. So it's not that we need to add it. So other questions?
Do you have a plan of how you are going to be educating the people in the state of Minnesota to vote yes on this?
Yes, actually we... the question of how we're going to... do we have a plan on how to educate the people? Well, we're here, and we will hopefully continue our relationships with our partners, League of Women Voters, because it's a voting issue, and to be educated, have educated voters. But also, we received a grant from the Women's Foundation of Minnesota, where we'll do some strategic planning of how do we create a message and run a statewide campaign. That is not my background or my skills. I'm a total volunteer, and we have great volunteers, but we need to have a very good plan of how do we educate people in a way that will be effective. So League will be involved with that. Any other questions? Any questions online? Yes. Yes, and there are states that rescinded. So another legislative session came in, and they said, no, we don't like that ERA. We're going to vote to rescind our approval of that Equal Rights Amendment. States did that to the 14th Amendment, the 15th Amendment. Actually, I think some might have done to the 19th Amendment. But the Constitution, the U.S. Constitution, says, no, it's a one-way street. Otherwise, you will go back and forth with every session. And so if you look at precedent from previous amendments that were challenged, we stand on good ground there that it's a one way. You can't rescind your approval for an amendment.
Okay, so an online question. Are there organized groups lobbying against these amendments in Minnesota? And repeat the question.
Question is whether there are organized groups that are lobbying against the Equal Rights Amendment. Nationally, I believe the U.S. Archdiocese has come out in opposition of the federal Equal Rights Amendment because of the issue around abortion. And usually we get a letter in our hearings from some level of Catholic organization or, what is it, families? We haven't had too many in the hearings we've had, but we do get some, yes, opposition around the issue of abortion. And also just fundamentally against women's rights to be equal. Yeah, two biggest opposition are abortion, and we haven't had organizational opposition at the Capitol. Usually it's, well, we did have a testifier from a woman who's with the Catholic, she works one place, but she was representing another. So it was an interesting conversation that she provided. But essentially she says, we don't need this, it's unnecessary, women are already equal. The numbers in reality don't prove that out, especially if you just look at the wage. You look at health care. Sexual violence, no, we're not equal. And so it's a very different perspective than most women have. So procedure-wise in Minnesota for an equal rights amendment, yes, House and Senate must pass it, and it's simple majority, and the governor has nothing to do with it. It's similar to the federal in that the president doesn't have anything to do with it. It's a state's rights issue. So in Minnesota, it is legislative bodies. House and Senate must pass it, and then it goes on the ballot in the 2024 election. And we'd like to pass it in 2023, because of the education campaign. We want people to be informed about the vote and be knowledgeable so when they come in to vote, they know how they're going to check the box. We want it to pass the legislature in 2023.
But on the ballot, you want it
2023
ballot or
24? 24 on the ballot, 23 through the legislature. Because we want the time to have the education campaign, the discussions over the next year. So it'll be a presidential election 2024, and we'll get better turnout, but we also want the time because it will need to be on a general ballot, a statewide ballot, so more of the locals are happening in 2023. So, do we have any concern of legislators not supporting the ERA in 2023? No, but we want to make sure that everybody is on board. Currently, both our House leadership and Senate leadership are on our bills. And we have the support, and people voted to have protect abortion rights. A lot of women and young people showed up, and they have elected this group of legislators. And as you know, they've been working very diligently, and the PRO Act was their first piece of legislation they absolutely wanted to get through. And that was their priority. So we stood by the wayside waiting for them to get done, and they're still working on, they have so many bills. But reality is we have assurance that they are supportive, our leadership is supportive, and we'd love to get, you know, all legislators. I mean, to me, it's a human rights issue, it's a equality issue, it shouldn't be partisan. So I really look forward to, I mean, if you were to say, I voted for the Equal Rights Amendment, or you said I didn't, I mean, your children, grandchildren, who would look at you and say, why? You know, and thank you if you do, because I think most people, younger people especially, believe in equality under the law for all people.
I have a couple of questions from online, and please ask you to repeat them. Can you give a couple more, a few concrete examples of how an ERA has been shown to be effective, maybe like in other states?
Yes. The Equal Rights Amendment, as I said, the Equal Rights Amendment, the question is about how it's been used in other states where they have an Equal Rights Amendment in their state constitution. As I mentioned, it's actually been used by more men in terms of being for job discrimination where they feel they are being paid less, such as nursing or opportunities for jobs. So that's where it works for everyone. There's parental rights issues, and that works for men and women. So it's not meant to be biased. It's meant to be, we want to be treated equally under the law, whether you're male, female, what your gender is, and that you would have that equal opportunity and access. So the state ERAs have been used for that in other states.
The other question, there's several ballot initiatives being considered this session. Is there a limit to how many can be on the ballot?
There's not technically a limit for how many amendments can be on a ballot, what we're hearing in Minnesota. But what they're saying to us, the leadership in our legislature, is they don't want a lot of ballot initiatives. If you think about California, they can have a lot. And other states have had a history of having many questions on their ballot for amendments or proposals that get added to their constitution, propositions. And in Minnesota, they're saying, no, we don't want 10 ballot questions on here. We do need to renew one of the lottery amendments that was funding for lottery. I don't know which one it is. There were two. That needs to be renewed because the time limit is up. And so there will be that one. I'm assuming they'll get that one through. And we hope to be on there as well. I don't know specifically how many other ones there are, but we want to be in that. We want to be in the top two. You've got a question, one more here? Yes, the question is what at the federal level would, what legal issues are around enacting the 28th Amendment? There was just a judiciary hearing, which was the first one in 40 years, the U.S. judiciary. They met and they had lawyers on both sides, and of course they had differences of opinion. But our lawyers, the ones I like, have said, Congress, you put the timeline on. Congress, you can take the timeline off. They have the power in the fifth Article 5 of the Constitution. And so that has been one of the, and that's been some of the court decisions. It's like, well, who's got the power here? Congress. Congress has the power. So as I mentioned, the U.S. House has taken, deleted the deadline, two sessions. And it's the Senate with their supermajority that has been difficult. But Chuck Schumer says he will call a vote in by April on in the Senate and bring it to the floor and try to get it passed to say delete the time limit. So then, of course, there'll be more lawsuits about that. But if you know, the 19th Amendment, they had lawsuits for years about, oh, can women serve on juries? Oh, what does this mean? Women got the right to vote, but can they do this? Can they do that? I'm surprised, but this is what lawyers do. They'll fight about things for years. So hopefully it'll be sooner than later that we get that resolved. But yes, that's been the decision so far with the courts is, Congress, you put this time limit in. Congress, you can take it off. Yes. Right. Right.
So,
yes, thank you for your interest, and hopefully we'll have more on the passage of the ERA.
Yes, yes, yes. So, thank you very much. So that wraps it up for tonight. Thank everybody for attending and for watching it, and we'll see you again.